Hopefully everybody can hear me. It's an honor to be here. I know I'm on the new construction side, but I want to tell you I have a real treat in store today. Commander Frank Weisser is our next speaker, and he's got a decorated naval aviation career. Probably, if you watch scenes of him on YouTube, I think he's the lowest altitude flying pilot that the Navy had had, and I don't know how many years, he can probably tell you. He flew all the best scenes in Top Gun Maverick. So if you remember the Dark Star taking out, I assume everybody here has seen Maverick, right? I mean, this is a Navy event. So,
hey, Brett, Admiral Downey here for a second.
Yes, sir.
Hey, for those that are smart enough to be back on time, this is like the best piece of Carrier Team 1, all right? So, Littleton, if you want to, somebody walk out there and tell them, I'm locking the doors. They don't get to come in if they're late, all right? Just no pressure, but we're not going to be disrespectful either. So just a subtle recommendation, all right?
Thanks, sir. So,
oh, boy.
I think on day one, Admiral Downey showed you a clip of the canyon run in Top Gun Maverick, and you might have thought Tom Cruise was flying that jet, but it was really our next speaker, Frank Weisser. And I don't want to take too much stage time from him because he's got a great presentation, but I do want to say, you know, you may be wondering why I'm up here introducing him. We were classmates at the Academy, and it's a real honor to know Frank, and I want to bring him up on stage. So without further ado, Frank Weisser.
Appreciate you. Hear me okay? Awesome. Even in the back? It'll start with this.
He's already on us! Oh, this is not good!
We took another hit!
No!
We can't outrun this guy. We got to eject.
What?
We need altitude. Pull the ejection handles the second I tell you.
Nav, wait!
Booster, there's no other way. Eject! Booster, pull the handle, eject!
It's not working!
Who has seen and
how about that? Better, okay. So for those who have not seen it, I do not intend to spoil it. There are no spoiler alerts in my presentation. My question for y'all is, what you just saw, real or fake? A mixture of both. Okay, the answer is both.
It's real because I actually flew that scene with Tom in my back seat. We flew that off the coast of Southern California. We were right off of LAX airspace, if you've ever flown in that military operating area down there.
It's fake because we weren't actually in an F-14. We were in F-18s. Tom was in my back seat. Rooster, the other actor, was in the back seat of a Top Gun instructor's jet, and they turned it using CGI into F-14s. It's also fake in the sense that we weren't in a dogfight with a Su-57, but Tom's perspective and the director Joe, who the Air Boss mentioned earlier, and Jerry Bruckheimer, their perspective on how we made this movie was that when they film airplanes, it has to be real. And you can't act the effect of flying in a fighter. You have to actually be in the fighter. And so they can act while they're in the jet, but they can't act like they're in the jet, if that makes sense. So we flew all of these scenes. We flew this one off of SoCal, like I said. What's fun for me when I remember this scene is we were down there off the water at 100 feet doing these high G turns. And then at the end of the turns, when the scene sets up this ejection, we'd have this 7 or 8 G pull up into the vertical. What was happening to us is that LA Center, the controlling agency that watches all these airplanes, doesn't see us because we're at 100 feet. We're not even on their radar. But all of a sudden, they have this F-18 doing a 50,000 foot per minute climb, and they're seeing it going right into the 787 inbound to Beijing or Hong Kong. And so LA Center's losing their mind with me. And they keep saying, Top Gun 1-1, Top Gun, are you done? State your intentions. And I say to Tom, hey man, are you done? And he says, I'm acting, bro, I'm acting. And I said, LA, sorry, we're still acting. And then we'd go back and do it again because we had to get the environmentals and the lighting just right. So we did this over and over again. And I just kept hearing, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry, Goose. Like 10 times in this one flight. And finally, when we sort of wrapped up, I said, I got to ask you, I don't want to be too nosy, I don't know what's going on, but did we just die? And he's like, no, 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 we live, you're good, man, okay. So when you see this scene, when you see this from the movie, this is Tom in the back seat of a Super Hornet off the coast of SoCal in this 7G climb up, because it really is hard to act like you're in a fighter unless you're actually in a fighter acting. So that's how we got to that. Now, what do we have in common here, and why am I here? Well, my involvement in this movie is tied very closely to the Blue Angels. And as the Air Boss kind of alluded to earlier, the Enterprise went to great trouble to bring in all the right people. So when it came to the dogfighting scenes, they brought in the instructors from Top Gun. When it came to the carrier scenes, they brought in the carrier instructors from the FRS. They were looking for a few specific scenes that were done at what I would call an extreme low altitude. Because normally for F-18 pilots, the lowest you fly is 200 feet. And that's once you're current and proficient. And at 200 feet, we talk about something called mission cross-check time. And what that means to us is you can look outside for this many seconds. And at 200 feet, you're allowed 1 second to look inside the cockpit. Everything else, your scan is outside. So if you want to deal with your radios, your weapon system, your navigation, you can only look in for 1 second. Otherwise, the biggest threat to you is the terrain, the obstructions, that sort of thing. So mission cross-check time at 200 feet is 1 second. If you want this airplane down at 10 or 20 feet, the mission cross-check time goes down a lot. It's essentially zero. You can't look inside because outside is your biggest threat. So how do we safely get these airplanes at low altitude? Well, their thought was to use a Blue Angel pilot, but the Blue Angels are on the road all the time. And so I was there, still attached to them, transitioning us to this new aircraft. So it became my role to fly some of these scenes. Now, what we have in common is this concept, teamwork. So I've flown with 11 Blue Angel teams, and all of them were great. Some were better than others. But what I learned about how highly effective teams operate came from some of the very best I was on. And your team is no different. Your team is certainly more complex. The fact that you build and maintain the most complicated piece of equipment ever known to man makes you already a good team. But what I know about teams is that good organizations change and great ones change really slowly. And I heard that quote years ago, but it rings true for me when I'm a part of a good organization. The idea being that if it's not broken, don't fix it. If you have a great thing going, if you tried to disassemble your entire CT1 and rebuild it from the ground up, it would take you decades to get to where you are right now. Same thing with the Blue Angels and how we do business. But when we function as a team, we're at our best. As a team, we're 6 airplanes, but not really. We're really 130 men and women, Navy and Marine Corps, who serve on this team. And I liken us most of the time to a football team, because what I love about the football analogy is when you watch a game, there are 11 players on the field from each team. And any one of those 11 players can drop the ball and the play fails and the team doesn't win. But really, it's not on those 11, it's on the entire support network. It's the coaches, it's the trainers, it's the people upstairs, it's the videographers. Everyone is relevant. Everyone is necessary for the success of that team. And from what I can gather from listening to the conversations from CT1, that is in fact the same way you guys are. Any single person can make or break this team. So if when the carrier comes pier side and you have either a 6-month or a 24-month availability, you have to hit your critical milestones. You can't rely on one or two people to make it work. You have to have everyone functioning as a team to make it work. So that's why the Blue Angels, I think, are a great team, and I think it has some corollaries to what you guys do.
I was at an air show in Wisconsin, and I went in to grab a Subway sandwich before the show, and a woman was in there, and she said, oh, the Blue Angels are in town. How many of you are there? And I said, well, we're about 130, but we brought 50 of us this weekend for the show. And she said, no, how many real Blue Angels? I said, well, we have 130 real Blue Angels, but only 50 of us are here. Well, how many of you fly? And I said, well, 6 airplanes are going to fly, but
none of those airplanes fly if it's not for the other 124 people that make this team operate. So as a team, we go all across the country, 30 to 35 cities per year. We perform for millions of people. And why do we do it? Why does the US Navy spend money on a team of air show pilots and maintenance professionals? Well, we do it because when the show ends, we climb out of the jets and we walk up to the crowd line and we interact with the young men and women who are there, the veterans, the children, you name it. But what we're not there to talk about is the Blue Angels. The air show gives us, it's a mechanism, it gives us the credibility to be able to take time from that young man or young woman who wants to hear us. And so we don't talk about the fact that we did loops to music. We say that at this exact moment, we're here in City Whateverville, beautiful weather, lots of people, but at this exact same moment, our brothers and sisters are shooting off an aircraft carrier at night into harm's way. And that's the really cool story. That's what we want to share. And if we could take you guys to the aircraft carrier, it would blow your mind. You'd all want to serve. Because it's incredible to see a carrier at sea in the North Arabian Sea function as safely and as effectively as it does. But we can't do that, so we try to bring a little bit of naval aviation to whatever city we're in. We get a chance to go all around, and we talk at civic groups, we talk at schools, and we share with them why we chose to serve and what it is we do. I like to use the landing analogy, and this one seems to resonate. I'll explain that if you're in aviation, landing is kind of a priority. There's always this joke, you have to have in your logbook the same amount of takeoffs and landings, or you've sort of screwed something up along the way. So landings matter. So in this case, perfect weather, daytime, long runway, a monkey could land that airplane, right? You change it up a little bit, it gets dark, you lose your visual cues. It's just like driving on the highway at night. It's hard to judge speed, distance, that sort of thing. It gets harder. It gets harder still, though, if you're landing on a moving vessel. That's a legacy F-18. When you're flying in that, the come aboard speed is 141 knots. That's about 165 miles an hour. So things happen pretty fast. If you want to make this a tiny bit harder, you already know where I'm going with this, I suspect. The hardest thing in all of aviation, across all services, across the entire aviation industry, is that. Can you see it? Because that's the aircraft carrier from 3 miles away. And if you look really closely, I know the lights are on here, but if you look closely and you picture a quad slide, in the center of the bottom left quadrant is the aircraft carrier, and that's what the pilot sees at 3 miles. So I'm gonna bring you into 20 seconds before landing. You can tell me when you get sighted the aircraft carrier. Haven't changed any of the color of the lighting. That is in fact what you see. And it's why most people who fly off these aircraft carriers love it during the daytime and absolutely hate it at nighttime. Because that is in fact how it is. But what you just saw ties into my next point, and that's focus. So every one of us, it doesn't matter what we do for a living, we at times during our day have to focus. You might have to focus individually, you might have to focus as a team. But when are the times when you are required to have absolute and total focus? I can guarantee you the pilot in that airplane had total focus, was not concerned about what's for dinner or what they're going to do later on. They're focused on the task at hand. So my question for you is, where are the times in your day-to-day activities that you are absolutely required to focus, where nothing else matters, where you have total clarity on the task at hand? On the Blue Angels, I'll show you what focus looked like, but first, as a bit of background, I was Blue Angel 5 and 6 during my different years on the team. And 5 and 6 are the solo pilots, and what that means for us is we're the maximum performance demonstrators. 4 airplanes fly in tight formation. The other 2 demonstrate how fast it can go, how high it can go, how many G's it can pull, and it starts on takeoff. So it looks like this. You can turn down the volume on the video. This is on the runway at NAS Pensacola. That's a perfect thing. Runway 25 left. We're in formation. I'm number 6. We run our engines up, and I pass a thumbs up. That indicates my airplane's ready to go. We release brakes together, and we accelerate to full afterburners. That gives us 32,000 pounds of thrust. What you'll notice about this video, though, is that my head is looking left almost all the time. When you're taught to fly, you always look straight ahead when you take off. We're looking left because I'm modulating my throttles to stay in perfect position on the ground even before we get airborne. When I look straight ahead like I am now, my wingman has already taken off and I'm airborne. So my gear's up, my flaps are up, the aircraft accelerates rapidly. 250 by midfield. At the end of the runway, it's 300 knots. And at 350 knots, both hands on the stick, all the way in the lap, seven times the force of gravity, and you're pointed vertically, you can see the smoke of the diamond already in the distance from their preceding maneuver. So that's the takeoff maneuver. But as I explained it there, the aircraft, if we do it just right, never leaves the same height it taxis at, meaning it takes off, but the gear and flaps come up, and you accelerate at that 3-foot altitude. The level of focus there is pretty intense. What you might not know about the Blue Angels is that we modify our airplane in several kind of key areas. When they become from a fleet airplane to a Blue Angel airplane, we take out the gun. We don't need the cannon in the front of the airplane. We put in a smoke tank that gives us that smoke. We also add a spring to the jet. And the spring is just a simple mechanical spring like Arnold Schwarzenegger used to use to expand his chest. That spring comes out of the floorboard. It attaches to the stick. And so to stay in level flight, you do a 40-pound curl. And you do that throughout the course of the flight. So if you want to climb or descend, you actually pull 50, 60 pounds. So imagine yourself in the gym, you're on a low row machine, and you've got one handle, it's 40 pounds. It's not that heavy, but after 20 minutes, it's pretty heavy. And after an hour, you just want to die. So you build up this tolerance to flying with the spring, but it gives you a great deal of control over the airplane. In that particular maneuver, though, half an ounce of relaxation on that spring, and you've crashed in literally a second. So there's a high degree of focus. And my point in saying this is we each can find the points in our day where we focus and prioritize them and then take our rest later when the time comes. Here's another aspect that's near and dear to your guys' hearts. Timelines matter to you, I know that. They certainly matter to us in tactical aviation. If you guys have that 6-month availability or a 24-month availability, you know what your timelines are and as they go. When we're flying in combat, we know what our timelines are. If I'm overhead, men and women on the ground asking for ordnance, the forward air controller says, I need this weapon based on CDE, I need it delivered at this location, plus or minus 1 foot, and at this time. And the timeline is the most critical aspect. Because if you come in too early, the good guys aren't out of the way. And if you come in too late, the bad guys have already left. So timelines matter. On the Blue Angels, I want to show you what our timelines look like. This is carried on from the maneuver you just saw. So this is the first of our maneuvers. I'm flying as the Blue Angel lead solo. I'm converging on center point at NAS Pensacola. You'll see the runway off in the distance and the smoke over the runway because that's where the Diamond just did their first maneuver. We accelerate from 10 miles apart and we're converging to a center point that's right at the center of that runway. We accelerate to 400 knots and you'll see me look right as I look at checkpoints. My 2-mile checkpoint is the stop sign coming over the bridge. That's the main bridge into Pensacola. You'll see me look for it. And then as I snap forward, I'm looking for my wingman and I'm updating my timeline to make sure I get there at the right time. So as we converge, you're going to see me looking left because the smoke is covering up the runway right now, so it's hard to see my wingman as we do a cross with 1,000 miles per hour closure. We come up in a knife edge for the first cross. You guys see him go by? Anybody? All right, we rewind. I'm going to go on 1/20th speed. Approaching center point, we pull back on the stick and push it forward. That puts the aircraft in ballistic flight. We roll up on our wings so our wingtips don't touch. And then we go into the first maneuver, which is the knife edge pass. So you see him now? If we do our job just right, the crowd sees that. Now here's the timeline aspect that matters. We're starting 10 miles away from each other, and we have to cross over center point 47 seconds later. Not 46 3/4, not 47 1/2. 47 seconds later we cross, because that's where the show is. And there's a trailer out there that we measure our success off of. So as we ingress, if either of us are off by even 1/4 of a second, it moves that hit 167 feet left to right. So if you're flying on a Saturday and you have 20 knots of wind behind you, and the day before you had 20 knots of wind in your face, and you don't change anything, your hit happens 4,000 feet away, and no one even sees you. So you're making constant adjustments to your timeline to make this hit work. Literally, you're adjusting your speed 1 knot. Instead of 400, I'm flying 399, because that's going to make or break that 100-foot hit as we cross. So we carry that on. That first maneuver's over. We go back out to 9.5, 10 miles away. I'll speed this up just a little bit for the purpose of showing you what we do. And we turn back in. We do the exact same maneuver over again, but because it's the Blue Angels, we have to do it upside down. So now, same maneuver, 1,000 miles of closure, but instead of the blood being pulled away from your head, the blood is being pushed towards your head as you get set up. And then following the cross, it's negative 3 Gs, so 3 times the force of your body being pushed into your eyes. Your eyes start to see red because of all the blood force in your brain, followed by a turn into behind the crowd. Now, this is our trickiest timeline of all right here that no one ever knows about because they're watching the Jets in front of them. The hardest thing on the Blue Angels is how we get back together before the next maneuver. So we have 30 to 45 seconds to rejoin for the next maneuver, and this is one where we're demonstrating the carrier landing capabilities of our aircraft. So we do that by putting down our gear and our flaps. We add the tail hook. You're all familiar with the tail hook, so we throw the tail. Did that freeze? All right, we'll skip that. Let's see. I'll let my audiovisual guys help me in the back as we get set up. So this brings up an interesting story. I was telling the air boss earlier. I've done a handful of these presentations over the last year, and I went to do one that was a bit odd. It was in a Baptist church. And I'm used to talking to military groups or flying clubs or even businesses, but a church was a new one for me. So I'm in front of about 1,100 men at a men's convention. And I got up. We had tested everything ahead of time, pretty robust system. And I clicked the first slide and it didn't come on. So I looked around and audiovisual came up to help. It was going to take a second. So I said, all right, well, while I got a moment, let me tell you guys a joke. So I've got 1,100 Baptist men staring at me. I said, all right, true story. There's an Air Force pilot. He died. He went to heaven. He gets up to the gates. I know it's working, but I want to tell you my story now. So he gets to the gates, and St. Peter's there, and he said, welcome, son. We're happy to have you here. You've lived a wonderful life. Welcome to heaven. And he said, I got one question. Are there any Navy pilots in this room? Are there any in heaven? Am I going to bump into any because I don't care for them? St. Peter said, don't worry about that, son. I don't think they're here. They weren't invited, and you have nothing to fear. So Air Force pilot goes into heaven, goes into the Great Hall, big grand room. At the end of one side, there's this massive mirror. And in front of the mirror, there's a Navy pilot. Flight suit unzipped way too far, leather coat on, collar up. And he's flexing and staring at himself in the mirror. And the Air Force guy's incensed. And he storms back out. He's like, St. Peter, you promised no Navy pilots in here. He said, my son, don't worry. That's not a Navy pilot. That's just God pretending. So I said that in the Baptist church, and I almost got booed out of there. Bad on me for telling a sacrilegious joke when I was in a moment of awkwardness. I will see if this will carry on here for us. Or maybe we can hit it in the back and see if it works. I have another joke if it doesn't. So as I mentioned, you converge on center point the exact same time. You're 9.4 to 9.8 miles apart, depending on the weather, for this maneuver. And then as you cross, you have all this blood rushing to your head. So everything when you're upside down happens backwards. If you want to go left, you have to tell the airplane to go right and vice versa. So it plays tricks on your mind. But as we push away and we go behind the crowd, as we get rejoined, what I was explaining is we go into the carrier landing configuration. And when this airplane lands on the carrier, it puts its gear down, it puts its tail hook down. And really, at that point, it's at the least maneuverable it can be. Because when you land an airplane, you want it to be stable, not maneuverable. What we want to demonstrate on the Blue Angels is the fact that even in our least maneuverable point, this airplane is so incredible that when it's the least maneuverable, it can do incredible things. So we get joined up and we fly right overhead the center point. But to do this, because it's the Blue Angels, we never do anything normal. So one airplane is always upside down. So we have to fly kind of a bizarre formation. We roll out on center point. You can only be inverted 1 mile right of where the show is. And you'll see, in this case, the lead solo rolls the aircraft inverted. You'll see this maneuver again in Top Gun Maverick, so that's a little sneak peek. So we fly in kind of this bizarre formation, and the intent of doing that is to get to that. If we do it just right, that's what you see. Aviation has an incredible way of teaching people how to deal with adversity, how to deal with challenge. I just got finished reading a book called The Checklist Manifesto, if anybody in here has read that. It was written by a doctor, and the book is basically tying in lessons learned in aviation to medicine and how a simple thing like the checklist revolutionized medicine. And as I'm listening to the panel earlier and some of the lectures, checklists come up in your daily life all the time. The idea was 1935, the U.S. Army Air Corps was trying to create the next bomber that would eventually be the bomber for World War II. And they had prototypes, they're testing them, so they had the most experienced test pilot in the entire Army Air Corps take off in the Model 299, but eventually the B-17. And on takeoff, the airplane rolls up on his wing, crashes into the ground. It was the most experienced test pilot there was, so how could they have failed? Well, they realized that there was a control lock that was preventing the elevators and the rudder from actually functioning. They were locked in place. And they needed to turn the lock off, basically stow the lock so the aircraft flight control surfaces could function. They didn't do it, they forgot. The immediate takeaway was, it's too hard for a human being to fly an airplane that complex. It can't be done. Let's scrap the whole thing. And then someone in the back of the room is like, I got an idea. Could we just make a little list of things that are critical and not forget to do those? And therein was born the first aviation checklist. And then medicine took advantage of it, and all the other industries have taken advantage of it because it's an easy way to deal with the unexpected. So adversity in aviation looks a bit like this. This is an air show in Canada flown by a Canadian CF-18, much like the Blue Angel airplanes. Loss of a right engine, incorrect procedure, successful ejection. What's interesting about this particular example is that Brian Buse was the pilot of this airplane. I was flying in air shows the same year this happened. And as I talked to Brian afterwards, because we're trying to pull his lessons learned out of this mishap, and he's telling us what exactly went wrong. He lost his engine in a slow speed pass. It's a terrible time to lose your engine because your airplane's flying on the other side of the power curve, if you've heard that term. The same amount of power to make it go slow, you could do 400 or 500 knots. But you're having to push this airplane through the sky so that when your engine fails, it doesn't have the power on one to even push itself through the sky, much less climb away. So he didn't do the correct procedures, but what's interesting is he survived the failed engine. He survived the ejection. He thought he was going to end up on top of the fireball in his canopy. He didn't. He survived that. But the scariest part was right now where you see his canopy still inflated, and in his opinion, he was being dragged to his death. And it's a beautiful air show day, 10 knots of wind, but that wind picked up his canopy. He couldn't deflate it, and he thought he was going to hit his head on a rock or a tree and die after all those other survivable aspects. We do the same exact maneuver on the Blue Angels, but we do it with two of us, and we do it really close together. So why are we willing to accept that risk if something goes wrong? Well, this is my point about aviation and how we deal with adversity, how we deal with challenges. We do it by being prepared and planning for the unexpected. So when we take new student pilots in flight school, before they ever get into an airplane, they learn everything that might go wrong and what to do when it does go wrong. And they memorize all these procedures. And then once they've been memorized, they're tested on them. Once they're tested on them, they're evaluated in the simulator. And once all that happens, then they get into the airplane. Because you can't get into the airplane for the first flight and hope nothing goes wrong. Well, I'm going to learn all that shit later. Right now, I'm just flying on flight number one. You can't. You have to be ready for everything before you take off the very first time. And that's how we deal with it. So my point in saying that is, what it comes up in your daily life, what are the problems, and do you go through a list of, these are all the things that could go wrong in my particular job, and if they did go wrong, what are the procedures I have to go through to fix them? Because if you do that, if you have a plan, if you have a procedure for every known thing that could go wrong, then you really have no problems at all. Solving all these problems becomes SOP. It just becomes your daily business, life in and out, right? This exact same thing happened to me off of Lake Michigan. My engine didn't quit. Our Blue Angel aircraft are maintained by the best sailors and Marines in the Navy Marine Corps, in my opinion. But I flew through a flock of seagulls. Harder to prepare for that, although we certainly try to. But the flock of seagulls destroyed really both of my engines, but the right one right away, it exploded. And so the proper procedure are, you dump the nose right away. It's counterintuitive, because you feel the airplane sinking. So to stuff the nose means you think you're going to crash, and you're making it happen faster, you're accelerating to the scene. Well, you do it because the airplane has to get to level to have the energy to fly. So you dump the nose, you go full power, you push the rudder against the yaw, and then you maintain 14 units alpha to climb away. And it works. If you do the procedure right, it works every time. And so that's my point in how you deal with adversity. The best recommendation I ever got, it's both in the airplane and out of the airplane, in dealing with a challenging scenario, is to always underreact. We have an expression in the Hornet, it's no fast hands in the cockpit. When things go wrong, take your time. Sit, if you're going to do anything, sit on your hands, because your hands are going to mislead you. They're going to want to act too fast. Process what's going on, and then figure out what the right course of action is. Same thing happens in human interaction. I don't think anyone who blows up on people around them say, I am really happy that I overreacted. I'm really happy that I exploded on that sailor with anger and rage in the heat of the moment. It was definitely the right way to handle that. I don't think anybody says that. So the idea that you can underreact, whether your airplane's on fire and exploding, or whether everything's perfect, to me seems like the right way to go. The last aspect, and this came up both with Admiral Miller and before in your panel, is trust. How do we trust one another? In your daily job, we trust people all the time. We trust you'll be back on time. We trust you'll pay someone back money. But we trust them with our lives, too. I call it high trust. When you trust someone else with your life, they trust you with their life over and over and over again. On the Blue Angels, it looks like this. A similar maneuver to what you saw earlier, but we're crossing with our wings level at a much higher speed, 1,200 miles per hour closure. What's interesting about this, did you see him go by? A little easier when we're not in the smoke. I'll pause it here for 1 second. This airplane has about a 42-foot wingspan, so from my head it extends 20 feet. From the head of the other aircraft, same thing. The wings are crossing with single-digit feet apart. And that sight picture becomes relevant for Top Gun Maverick, and you're going to see that again shortly. So we accelerate into the vertical, we come down, we roll again as we cross, and then after we cross this final time, our solo routine is over, and we set up for the Delta. As we get into formation, I'll fast forward just a bit here, but we put all six planes in what we call the Delta formation. The idea in the Delta, and you can see here on the upper left, you see Blue Angels 2, and then behind Blue Angel 2 is Blue Angel 1. If I'm doing my job just right, I'm covering up number 1's head with number 2's head. That's we're in a balanced formation. But watch this video for just a moment and see if anything catches you as odd or off guard. We're in a descending accelerating turn towards the runway in Pensacola for our final landing maneuver when we do a pitch up brake to land. And as you're flying, for those of you who have any time in airplanes, you'll know that you get accustomed to learning what the threats are. And those threats are the terrain, the trees, the towers, the obstructions. And your spidey senses are going nuts as you feel the aircraft accelerate, you feel all these things going by in your periphery. Right as we get over center point, number 1 breaks away, then number 2 breaks away in order. We don't take cameras in our airplane. That's a sort of a Blue Angel rule for us. But Boeing every now and again will put in cameras for their own purposes of multimedia. And so Boeing had put this camera in my jet. I watched it subsequently. And when I saw that video, I was blown away. It never occurred to me that in the course of that maneuver, I never looked straight ahead. For the entire turn, this descending, accelerating turn, I was looking only at the other wingman to maintain the proper formation. And the fact is, like I mentioned, mission cross-check time, if you're in a formation with six airplanes that close together at that speed, if you look away for even a second, you've already put yourself out of position. Because your hands and your brain, you're making so many corrections so fast that you can't even afford 1 second of looking away. So that's this level of trust. There's a really famous Thunderbird, the Air Force team. They had a mishap in Creech Air Force Base, for those of you who heard about it, in the T-38. All four of their Diamond airplanes flew straight in the ground. One made a mistake, Thunderbird number 1, the flight lead. 2, 3, and 4 just follow their lead, and they all end up in the dirt. And there's a great deal of trust that's placed in each of these people. 2 through 6 are trusting number 1, but number 1 is also trusting that everybody else flies their position so they don't have a midair inside of that formation. So that's this level of trust. All of this stuff came together when we made this movie, starting about in the summer of 18. My involvement, like I mentioned, was because they were looking for one particular pilot to fly a low altitude scene. And because of all these maneuvers that you've just seen, we were trying to find a way to mitigate the risk. In the first movie, a pilot died. I don't know how many people are aware of that, but it was a civilian pilot named Art Scholl. And he was in a civilian aircraft filming a flat spin out to sea. And eventually the controls got locked and he crashed out to sea and was never found. I can certainly speak for the Admiral and say that he was unwilling to accept the risk of one of the air crew dying or certainly losing an airplane. So how do we make an incredible movie and mitigate the risk? Well, we did it by, like I explained, they found the right SMEs to fly each of the scenes. My scenes were kind of the brain dead ones. Can you just fly an airplane low altitude? So the first scene I was involved in was this one. Once again, no spoiler alerts here, I promise. Real or fake? Both. It's real. I flew those. That's off of Fort Rosecrans at Point Loma, for those of you who've been to San Diego. It's right by NAS North Island. It's real because I took a Blue Angel airplane out there. We did that exact same flyover. Oddly enough, this was my first event filming for Top Gun Maverick. And so I'm basically doing a recce of where we're going to fly this scene. So I go out to this cemetery that really exists. And I get there, and they're just buses and buses and buses. I don't know what they're for. I'm just trying to lay eyes on where I'm flying over that afternoon. And as I'm in my flight suit, I was in 05, I'm walking down the street, and here past me walks a four-star admiral. It's like, holy shit. Hello, sir. Hey, how's it going? We walk by another 30 feet later, three-star admiral. How's it going? And I walk over the course of about 50 meters, I see probably three or four three- and four-star admirals. And the final one that walked by me was 19 years old. I'm like, what the fuck is going on? Where are all these 19-year-old admirals coming from? I was oblivious to the fact they were using extras from all over, and that was an E3 in one of the VRC squadrons, who was more than happy to salute me, and it was a very unique aspect of this movie that you had no idea who anyone was. It could be an actor or actress in a flight suit, it could be an actual Navy pilot, or it could be an E3 that was a lineman who is now a three-star. But we flew the scene over and over again. The interesting part about this for me is it's trust related. And so the scene I just showed you about trust in the Blue Angel airplane, to film this right, the sun was setting to the west. I was ingressing from the west, going overhead the cemetery. But as the sun set, everything to the east was dark. And I was in a very old F-18, an F-18A. And so the inertial nav system is not great. It roughly can approximate where you are, but it certainly can't pinpoint a casket or a group of people. And this target was drifting constantly. So I'm relying on two people to say higher, lower, left, right. And we're barely scraping over these trees. And so there's a lot of faith and trust in my end when basically all I'm seeing is darkness to fly this thing just right. And the next time, a little bit lower, a little bit lower. And as you get there, you feel these trees going right underneath you. And you're saying, boy, I hope you guys take care of me. It's that level of trust. Another scene that you probably remember. This is the second scene I filmed for the movie. Real or fake? Both. So what's interesting about this is we really flew it. I'll show you how we practiced for it. I'll show you what we did. In fact, to get it just right, Paramount wanted, they knew it was going to be the Dark Star. The Dark Star didn't take off. That's why it's fake. But it's real because we flew it with the Blue Angel airplane, and we practiced to see how could we get the right effect on the set.
Was the best.
That was awesome.
So we're trying to figure out, do we want low and fast? Do we want high? Do we want to push the nozzles towards the ground? There was a light pole in my way, and they kept asking me to go lower. And the light pole, although I probably wouldn't have hit it, it would have been 1 or 2 feet off my wing, and I felt like I was gonna. So the F-18 has a really cool switch that makes light poles go away. And so if you see the light pole in the back left there, you'll see our second run. Once the light pole went away and it broke, we took it down. And then we could try low and fast. And so low and fast gives really cool pictures, but you saw it didn't do much to the terrain, right? And so what we eventually agreed on doing was we brought the aircraft in at about 15 feet and we pitched it up at the perfect speed to give the maximum climb efficiency, and it directed that thrust at the ground. And what actually happened was, on our one take, we could only do it one time because there was an actor named Ed Harris who was out there, and that was it. We got one chance. He has hair and makeup done, and it's on, and the roof came off the building. And the director almost wasn't willing to put this into the movie because he thought everyone's going to assume it's fake. But in fact, it really happened. The only reason that roof didn't end up on top of the actors is because you can see on each corner of it, there's some conduit that comes from the walls into it and then back down. So the conduit is the only reason that that roof didn't end up on top of Ed Harris. And the fact that we filmed it in real life and they didn't want to use it because they thought it would look fake is awesome. That is one of the coolest things about naval aviation, that we do shit that's so cool that people don't even believe it.
So what's the story with you and Maverick?
It seems like he's got you a little rattled.
It's none of your business. Now, where the hell is he?
Been here the whole time.
Holy shit.
You see me now? Come on, let's get it over with.
Fight's on!
Real or fake? Real. 100% real. We filmed it just like you saw it. We filmed that using this airplane. And so the way to do that, you have to have these high-def cameras. We couldn't just put a cameraman in the back of an F-18. So the aerial liaison for the movie created the Cinejet. This is a group of L-39s that fly air shows, mostly on the West Coast, called the Patriot Jet Team. And they put this massive camera on the front. So we get ready to film this. It kind of harkens back to the first movie, right? But we want to do it for real. So myself and the movie's liaison call the air boss and say, we can do this. It can be done. It's a Blue Angel maneuver. You just saw it in the video where that one aircraft was upside down, right, in that carrier landing. And it's easier because we're not going to put our gear down. So we can do it. So I went up to Pax River where I was doing the testing anyway for the Super Hornet, and we decided to test it and to see how long can this aircraft fly inverted. That's a trick because on the Blue Angels, we have an inverted fuel pump, so you can fly almost forever upside down. But this was a traditional F-18, so we tested it with the engineers in the sim over and over again. Well, I'm a smart guy, so I was smart enough to, on Wikipedia, type in L-39, and it says it can do 380 knots. So I'm like, that's good. I can do that. So we test it at 380, upside down. I get about 28 seconds of inverted time before things start to go bad fast. And then I said, while we're here, let's test it at 350, and it flew okay. And we decided, because it's Pax River and that's what they do for a living, we'll just keep testing it until it doesn't work anymore. So we got down to 250 knots, and that was at a point where the aircraft was basically not controllable anymore inverted. So we get out to film that particular scene, and we get over Fallon, the high desert. The L-39's filming it, and the L-39 says, I can get to about 260 knots. Because I have this big camera on the nose, and it's like a barn door, and it slows me down. So the thing is, we gave it a shot, because we had just tested it. I knew the airplane would work, and it worked exactly like the sim showed, which was really cool. But what's interesting about this, and the reason I have this picture on the screen, is because no one that I know has even noticed the fact that my airplane inverted is in a little bit of a slow speed pass. So instead of being level and inverted, it's cocked up 5 degrees negative so that it can maintain that slow speed flight. But that is in fact the CO of Top Gun in the upright plane and me inverted there above him. All right, one last scene here that I think I'll remember. Real. Everything you see there, to get that scene, we filmed it with this camera. That's a IMAX camera, the first time they'd ever put it on the wing of the airplane. They installed it there. They even gave it ballast in the back, which I thought was kind of them, being that we normally carry 2,000-pound bombs there and we don't really need ballast, but they were thoughtful. So we added this IMAX camera, and we filmed that scene just like you saw it. We took scenes like this to get that pass. They referred to it as the Lawrence of Arabia pass. That is, The movie Lawrence of Arabia had a little dot in the distance that turned into a man on a horse. In this case, the Top Gun equivalent was a little dot in the distance that turned into a Super Hornet doing 500 knots. So to film it, we set this thing up and we flew a racetrack pattern. So we're out in Fallon, we're in Bravo 20, the high desert up there, and we're going outbound. They wanted my airplane down and set 8 to 10 miles away. So down at 10 or 20 feet, all that distance away. I would use the analogy of, I'm trying to find them visually. I have my system tells me approximately where they are. But if you picture yourself on one end of a football field, you can see someone on the other end. You can see a human being 300 feet away. But if that same human is 60,000 feet away, it's really hard to see him, right? You can't. So I'm like, yeah, I'll give it a go. And I flew 12 miles away. I turned, I descended and accelerated, and then set up the first of our passes. Got it. Two people in the foreground, there's the assistant producer to Bruckheimer and the director behind him. And this was the first pass. I will tell you, I was out of my mind happy that I'd found him. I was convinced I was going to end up like 3 miles away and they're going to be like, did you do it? I'm like, I did it. Did you see me? Nothing. But I flew over him. I was quite pleased with myself. The director comes on the radio and says, I loved it. Can you bring it 1 foot to the right?
And so that goes back to perspective. My perspective was I did a really freaking good job. I was lucky I found him. His perspective was on this beautiful camera they have, I needed the airplane a little bit over to make it perfectly balanced in the lens, right? So we tried again and again. But what he didn't get is the fact that to do that and to move it 1 foot right, you can't turn that airplane, because when you turn an airplane, the wings go down in the direction you're turning. So at that altitude, if you turned, your wing would be in the dirt. And I can't yaw the airplane, because if you even breathe on the rudder, the whole airplane's going to shudder, and it's going to translate hundreds of feet. So 1 foot was about as close as I was going to get. Let's go to another scene here. This scene, I understand, has gotten the attention of some of the leadership in CT1.
Hey, man, ease up. The canyon's getting tighter. Negative payback. Increase your speed. You're going too fast, man.
Well, no harm in being ahead of schedule.
Damn it, slow down. I can't stay on the course. Ah, you're going to hit the wall. Watch out, watch out, watch out.
Well, real, 100% real. So this is, in this case, the back of my head flying as hangman. Anytime you see in this movie the helmet from behind, that's an actual Navy pilot. And they're flying with a look-back camera, but all the other times you're seeing this massive amount of cameras pointing at the actors. In this particular case, we filmed it just like you saw, and what Paramount's direction to me was is go fly through this canyon. You don't have to go that low. This is just a test run. You're going to fly with hangman, and we really want to show in the script that no one can get as low as Tom. So just go learn this canyon. But the point of me showing this is because for the script of this movie, Maverick laid out his requirements. For those who have seen it, he said, we have to do this at this altitude, at this speed, or it just doesn't work. And in real life, they did the same thing with me. We have to get your airplane as low as it can go safely. We have to do this to make this change point in the movie happen. And the same thing is true for you guys. You lay out your requirements, and then you say, we have to make it. We have to make these timelines, or it's just not going to work. So how are we going to get there? How are we going to provide ourselves the right materials and resources to do it? Well, if you do it right, for me, it looked like this. I got the coordinates for this canyon. That's step one, right? If you're knucklehead Frank here, and you're trying to figure out how to put this airplane at crazy low altitudes, you get all the coordinates, and then I go to Google Earth. I did this in my BOQ room while I was waiting for the next shoot. I figure out where NAS Fallon is. Okay, I know it's about there. I'm not a Top Gun instructor, so I hadn't been out there. 80 miles to the east is Toyabe. I have my waypoints, and so I zoom in on a MacBook. And the cool thing about this recon and this study is I can go exactly to the point where I'm gonna fly my airplane. I'm gonna get the exact eyeball cal. I'm gonna see exactly how it looks to me at 200 feet, at 100 feet. I can know how many seconds it takes me until I get to my next turn point. I know how many G's I'm gonna have to pull until to get to the next point. Each mountain that I'm gonna have to cross, do I cross it in the wings level? Do I cross it inverted in a pull? And you can walk through this exact same route to the point where I'm flying it with my eyes closed from my seat. Because that's what I have to do, because when it happens for real, you already have to be prepared. Going back to dealing with adversity, I have to be ready to fly this route and have things break at the exact same time. So when you see it in the movie, it looks like this. So I'm not even gonna ask you, because you already know the answer, right? Everything you just saw there was real. It was filmed on a couple different days when we flew this, and we had to do it over and over again because the environmentals had to be just right. Paramount put a great deal of effort into making sure there was continuity throughout the movie, that when the airplane took off, if it was filmed on different days, but the clouds were in a different place in the sky, we had to scrap it and start over. So to film that, this is a great quote I love, and it applies to your team for sure, but it definitely applied to me that day. It's amazing what you can accomplish if you don't care who gets the credit. Because when you see a pilot from the back, that's not Tom Cruise, that's not Glenn, that's, in this particular case, it's me, but in any case, it's a Navy pilot, man or woman, flying that airplane. But Paramount really cares about being perfect in terms of not being called out for inconsistencies. So I will tell you for sure, never in my life have I had my hair any longer than it is right now. So that's definitely not my hair under that helmet. So Paramount decides, if I go the right direction, to glue Tom's hair to mine.
And that hairpiece was flown up from LA on a Honda jet just before that flight to make sure that even from the back, my head looked like Tom's. So that low altitude scene that I explained, how challenging it was, where at low altitude, you don't have any time to do anything else. I was really pleased that I overflew them. I have no idea of knowing what exactly they're looking for. What I didn't know until we landed that night was the fact that they had already gotten the shot they wanted, and we did it five or six more times because they were all taking selfies. So normally this is my last scene. I feel like this audience deserves one additional scene, and so give me 30 seconds, I'm gonna share this.
Maverick is downwind. No front landing gear, no tail hook. Pull the cable and raise the barricade.
Foul deck, foul deck!
So millions of people saw that, into the movie, the exclamation point of the movie, and they thought nothing of it, aside from maybe that Maverick is a great pilot and was able to land this emergency aircraft. But what everyone in this room knows, and everyone who served knows, is that's not the case at all, right? There are hundreds, if not thousands, of dedicated professionals who allowed that to happen. And what's cool to me is the people in this room get it, but everybody else in the theaters didn't get it. The fact that that system was built, was maintained by Carrier Team One in an arena that says it's only going to be tested once every 10 or 20 years, but when it does get tested, it has to work perfectly. And it worked, just like it's supposed to, and it would again and again and again. And so I think that's really incredible that that's kind of how they ended this movie. It took a group of professionals who are doing this high quality maintenance that get no appreciation for it to get it done. So on behalf of someone who's flown off aircraft carriers for 20 years and has benefited from the hard work and the unappreciated work from everybody in this room, I'd like to say thank you. Thank you for having me, and enjoy the rest of the week. And Kelly, did you want to do questions? Do we have a few minutes? Okay. All right, Kelly said we have just a few minutes. If there's any questions, and while you guys think, there was a question right before I walked up. It was, who puked on the movie? And that's a question I get often. And to my understanding, Tom never pukes, but he flies a lot. The only person who didn't puke was the female pilot actress, Monica, who played the character of Phoenix. She was an absolute stud. And that harkens back to my time flying with the Blue Angels. My first year, I gave VIP backseat rides, 300 rides over the course of a year. And I flew with a number of Hall of Famers, football players, actors, athletes, and most of these guys, NASCAR racers who won the event for the year, most all of them turned into jelly. But almost without fail, my strongest riders was the 65-year-old female guidance counselor who just loved the flight. So I don't know why that is that way, but it is in fact the case. Yes, sir?
Hey, so I'm gonna make this a little more personal. I'm gonna take it back. I love what you did on the movie and all that, but as a combat operator, right? As a soft tier one operator, I wanna say thank you, right? Personally, thank you, because you guys put warheads on foreheads who have saved my life, have brought other boys home, and destroyed the enemies of our country. I know people don't like to hear that, but on that level, we don't get to tell you enough. Thank you for saving my ass in a combat
thank
zone.
You. Undeserved, but appreciated. I think most of us who are in the air would like to be on the ground in the thick of things as well. We all just want to be involved. And what's interesting to me as one of the people who got to participate in this movie is a lot of my civilian friends who don't get it say, what an incredible way to end your career. And I said, I'd have rather ended my career on a fly off from a carrier after a deployment. That's the stuff that matters to me. It's what we do overseas when it's our men and women on the ground. That's the really cool shit. This is just a movie. But the benefit of this movie is it might bring in a lot more people into our Navy and Marine Corps that then get to carry that torch forward, right? Any other parting shots? Okay. Thank you guys for having me. Have a great week.